as you take your seat today, I just want you to tap yourself and say, a new day has dawned. A new day has dawned. A new day has dawned. Amen. Somebody should be shouting already. Amen. Because that means the old day is no longer active in your life. Amen. A new day has dawned. Hallelujah, and bless his name. My brothers and sisters, over the past several months, we have been forced to view some horrific images. Images that have spoken volumes, and those images have reminded us that a picture is worth a thousand words. We've seen images of George Floyd screaming, "I can't breathe," due to a knee shoved into the side of his neck. We've seen images of Breonna Taylor's face painted on a playground mural that will forever remind us of the life stolen while sleeping. We've seen images of Ahmaud Arbery taking a jog, which ultimately turns into a run for his life, a race, unfortunately, that he would lose. We have seen images of portable morgues set up at hospitals and funeral homes as a result of a deadly pandemic that was blown off as merely a hoax. We have seen images of military personnel being used to trample peaceful protesters as a false statement of law and order. We've seen images of masks being worn by people who are concerned about not only their well-being, but they're also concerned about the well-being of other people. We've also seen images of people not wearing masks in defiance of science, common sense, and even communal responsibility. We've seen images of intense racial divide, extreme political polarization, and unfathomable social injustice. With all of these images infiltrating our minds and flooding the airwaves, it's no wonder a whole lot of people have resigned themselves to having pessimistic outlooks about their future. Images are powerful. Somebody should say, yes, they are. Images are powerful, so much so that images can alter our moods and our feelings. Images are powerful, and that's why it's always important to have something better to look at in your life. Images are powerful because they can elicit gloom and doom, or they can excite your joy and your peace. Images can be a dark cloud on your parade, or they can spark a celebration in your life. And that's why Advent is so significant, because Advent provides us with the image that a new day has dawned. Advent presents for us another image. Somebody shout, another image. Another image, an image that speaks to wholeness and health. Peace and prosperity, sacrifice and commitment, compassion and empathy, love and unity. During Advent, we see lights illuminating the dark skylines as a way of saying that there is light shining in the midst of the darkness that surrounds all of our lives. God, in the person of Jesus Christ, showed up in the dark despair of humanity, and he shows up to offer us another image, an image of celebration. That's the image the prophet Isaiah is painting for all of us today. This particular passage of scripture in Isaiah chapter number 9 addresses the light of a new king. It addresses the dawning of a new day. This is a prophetic hymn that's composed to celebrate the birth of a new crown prince. The overall structure of the poem has similarities to hymns of thanksgiving because it gives us both an account of trouble and an account of salvation. And I believe I've already spoken to somebody right through there, because if you look at the journey of your life just over the last 11 months, back up, rewind, John, over the last 7 days, you will find both trouble and salvation. Trouble had existed in the text in the form of darkness. And you have to go back to Isaiah chapter number 8, verses 21 through 22 to find out what he's talking about. Because in Isaiah chapter number 8, verses 21 through 22, the Bible says they will go from one place to another, weary and hungry. And because they are hungry, they will rage and curse their king and their God. They will look up to heaven and down at the earth. But wherever they look, there will be trouble and anguish and dark despair. They will be thrown out into the darkness. The image of darkness denotes a picture of God being silent in the activities of humanity. And in chapter 9, verse 1, the author picks up right there where chapter 8 ended off. See, there is this image of darkness that's tucked away. There's an image of darkness, but behind the image of darkness tucked away is a cause for celebration. And I think I just spoke to about three people right there, because you showed up on a Sunday morning and you said, "Preacher, I got all this mess going on in my life and I need to find one glimmer of hope, one glimmer of reason to help me celebrate." And the Lord sent me to tell you that you have a reason to celebrate because a new day has dawned. The mood between verses 4 through 7 is a mood of joyous celebration. And they are celebrating because there is the release from both military and political danger. The Lord is the one who is praised as the one who has shattered the yoke and the rod of their oppressor in verse number 4. Because when you read the NIV translation or the Revised Standard Version, it lets you know that this act has already taken place. The Lord is the one who has shattered the yoke and of the oppressor in verse number 4. And the Lord is the one who is responsible for the battle gear of the enemy being destroyed in verse number 5. The language suggests to us that a past action has already taken place. And that's a good spot to remind somebody who showed up on this Sunday morning that God has already done it. I hear you saying, "Preacher, I can't see what God has already done." The victory that you've been waiting on, God has already done it. Against the backdrop of all the darkness in our lives, the author is letting us know that we have a reason to celebrate because of what God did in Jesus. Because of what God did in Jesus, a new day has dawned. You have a reason to celebrate today, my brothers and sisters, because God has already done it. Celebrate because God has already defeated your enemy. God has already lifted your burden. God has already shattered the enemy's yoke off your life. So you might as well pause right where you are and lift up both your hands and give God the praise and just say, "God has already done it." See, Jesus' birth is a counter image to the image that was most prevalent in the lives of God's people. Jesus' birth was a contrasting image that provided an alternative image to what they were dealing with on a daily basis. Jesus' birth was an alternative reality to the reality that they have already been living. Jesus' birth was not fake news, but his birth was breaking news. Jesus' birth was an interruption to the norm of the day. And God told me to remind somebody or to tell somebody that Jesus Christ has shown up during this season to interrupt your previously scheduled programming. See, back in the days, Billy Coles, back in the days when we watched TV, and when there was going to be an interruption, there was this big long beep on the TV and the picture froze. Sometimes the picture went blank and there was writing on the TV screen. And that was to alert you that something has now interrupted the programming you was previously watching. And that's what Jesus did. Jesus showed up in the darkness of humanity to interrupt the previously scheduled programming that the folk were watching. He showed up to remind them that a new day has dawned. And this text is about celebrating what God has already done. Despite what the images of darkness are trying to tell you, see, not only has God brought them deliverance from the military and the political dangers that they face, but God has also announced the beginning of a new political administration. Don't miss that. God delivered them from the military and the political dangers they were facing, but then God ushers them in to a brand new political administration. And this was not a Biden-Harris administration, but this was a Jesus Christ administration. See, verse 6 highlights for us the announcement of a birth. And verse 7 points us towards the future reign of justice and righteousness that this new king would have. See, now in order to fully appreciate what these verses are telling us today, you have to read them as reporting a past action. You have to read them not as something that's going to happen in the future, because here's the news. Jesus is not going to be born again because he's already been born. So if you want to understand the power of those verses, you have to read them in the context that something has already taken place. See, verse 6 is a result clause. Can I teach it for a minute? It is a result clause. It lets us know that things prior to this verse happened as a result of what verse 6 did. Y'all just missed your holler right there. See, verse 6 is a result clause. It lets us know that you can appreciate what happened in verses 1 through 5 because of what verse 6 has already said. See, and if you read that incorrectly, if you read it correctly in light of that fact, then it says to you, not a child will be born, but it says a child has been born to us. Not that the government will rest upon his shoulders, but authority already rests on his shoulders. And therein, my brothers and sisters, lies the power of Advent. See, we celebrate Advent because there has been a release from an oppressor. We celebrate Advent because there has been the destruction of an enemy's battle gear. And we celebrate Advent because there is the birth of peace, that the Prince of Peace came to give us hope and to give us peace. These are not some future events, but these are past events that lay the foundation for our confidence in the future. See, one of the reasons you can have peace about your tomorrow is because you understand what God did on yesterday. One of the reasons you can have peace in your today is because you recognize what God did on yesterday. See, Jesus Christ, when Jesus showed up, peace was not some far off, distant experience, but peace became a present and a right now reality. I wish you would tap your own self and say, we have peace already. This was a birth announcement, but I want you to notice something while I'm already teaching. I want you to notice that this birth announcement was not one declared by God, but it was declared to God. Don't miss that. This was not an angel declaring what God was going to do. This was not God himself saying what God was going to do, but this was the prophet who was speaking to God on behalf of the people. Come on in the room, y'all. See, the prophet speaks on behalf of the people to Almighty God. And the people declare through the mouth of the prophet that peace has already come to their lives because of Jesus Christ. I'll rewind and say it again. I know y'all missed that, so let me go back and catch it on the back end. Jesus, the Bible is saying that Jesus Christ showed up, and this was not an announcement by God to the people, but this was an announcement by the people to Almighty God. That Isaiah the prophet was standing, and he was declaring to God that because of what God had already done in Jesus, that things had already changed, that there was a breaking of dawn in their lives. And the birth of Jesus Christ reports a sign of change in all of our lives. It denotes the fact that Jesus' birth has trumped, if you will, any and all signs of the degradation, the deprivation, the despair, and the doom that darkness has declared over our lives. Jesus' birth was no ordinary birth, because it signifies for us the birth of a crown prince. And whenever a crown prince is born, he ain't no ordinary child. There was a season when God seemed silent in the lives of God's people. There was a time when unrest ruled the hearts and the minds of God's people. There was a time when things appeared to be chaotic and discouraging, but God in his faithfulness provided a remedy to their situation. God in his faithfulness provided a solution to their problem. And what Isaiah is telling us today is that a child has been born. And this child is no ordinary boy. I know you want to say he's Mary's baby, but he ain't no ordinary boy. I know you want to say he's Joseph's stepchild, but he ain't no ordinary boy. This child will become known as the Prince of Peace. This child will be a sign of God's saving activity on behalf of the people of God. This child would forever sit on the throne, and he would forever administer truth and justice, righteousness and mercy, peace and favor. This child would usher in the reign of peace that corresponds to the will of God. And the Lord told me to tell somebody that it is His will that you be made whole. It is the will of God that you thrive. It is the will of God that you rise from the ashes. It is the will of God that you overcome the adversity. It is the will of God that you conquer all your obstacles. It is the will of God that you climb the mountains. And it is the will of God that you prosper in all of your ways. This child that was born will forever heal the inner turmoil that we all struggle with. This child that was born would free us from the prison of low self-esteem. This child that was born would lift us from the dungeons of addiction and alienation. This child that was born would pull us out of the traps of the dark world. This child that was born will unite our dreams and our drives, will unite our passions and our purposes, will unite our desires and our destinies. This child will forever change our lives. And I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm so glad that God sent us Jesus, because this child, the Prince of Peace, would forever change our outlook. He would forever change our disposition. His presence brought peace. And can I tell you something? Peace is not always how you feel or what's happening around you, but peace is rooted in what you know. And when you know who has you, you can rest in peace. When you know who defends you, you can rest in peace. When you know who loves you, you can rest in peace. When you know who always has the last say, you can rest in peace. When you know that your future is already secured and your victories are already guaranteed and your destiny is preserved and your struggles are conquered, you can rest in peace. Why can I rest in peace, preacher? Because He is the Prince of Peace. And because Jesus is who He is, you can find peace with Almighty God. Because Jesus is who He is, you can find peace with yourself. Because Jesus is who He is, He draws us toward His promise of abundant life. He draws us towards the promise of joy. He draws us towards the promise of hope. He draws us towards the promise of love. And He draws us towards the promise of peace. In the time of darkness, God was drawing them to something that they longed for. In the time of darkness, God was drawing them to something that they prayed for. In the time of darkness, God was drawing them to something that they languished over. And in the time of darkness, God was drawing them to something that God had already done. I wish you would tap yourself and say, God has already done it. God had provided humanity with perpetual peace, a peace that surpasses all understanding, a peace that rules in the hearts and minds of God's people, a peace not like the world gives, but a peace through Jesus Christ. We now have peace with God, and I don't know how you feel about it. Because of this child, we are no longer bound, but we are delivered. Because of this child, we are no longer lost, but we are found. Because of this child, we are no longer weary, but we find strength. Because of this child, we no longer are joyless, because we're now joyful. Because of this child, we're no longer hopeless, but we're now hopeful. And I wish you would just tap your own self and say, self, we coming up out of this today, because this is the dawning of a new day in my life. Everything that was not right, I claim as is right. Everything that went wrong, I know God's going to work it out for my good, because God has given me peace. That's what Daniel had. He had the kind of peace that would allow him to walk up in a lion's den and not worry about what was going on in his life. That's the kind of peace that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego had, when they could go up in a fiery furnace and weren't afraid of the fire. That's the kind of peace that Jesus had when He walked back into the land and they were waving palms and singing Hosanna. But on Friday, He knew His life was going to end. On Friday, they hung Him up high. On Friday, they hung Him wide. On Friday, they pierced Him in His side. But because He had the peace of God ruling on the inside of Him, He could face Friday and go and stay dead all day Saturday, because God's peace was in his heart. He understood that God might not be around when I need him, but I've learned that he will always show up. Because he had the peace of God, he could stay in that place of confinement. He could stay in that place of restriction. He can stay in that place of darkness. Because he had the peace of God, he could stay where he was, immobilized. Because he had the peace of God, he could stay where he was, limited in his movement. Because he had the peace of God, and things around him didn't look good, he knew that Sunday was coming. And I wish you would tap yourself and say, preacher, I know something about Sunday, because I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. I'm walking and talking with my mind stayed on Jesus, and can't nobody do me like the Lord can. Jesus laid there all day Saturday, but the peace of God ruled his heart and his mind. And early Sunday morning, darkness turned into daylight. Early Sunday morning, the tomb turned into an escape route. Early Sunday morning, what was not now became. On Sunday morning, what they thought they had lost, they realized they still had. And I don't know how you feel about it, but God has a way of giving you the kind of peace that will remind you that what you think you've lost, you still have. You think you've lost it, but God will remind you by his peace, you still got it. Because the Prince of Peace will keep your heart and keep your mind in Christ Jesus. So celebrate today. Celebrate what God has already done, because this is the dawning of a new day in your life. Trouble don't worry you no more. Problems can't hold you no more. Sickness can't leave home, keep you no more. You got to get up on your own two feet and look the devil in the face and say, it was dark on yesterday. It was dark last week. It was dark last month. The last 9 months have been discouraging, has been so disheartening. But despite what it has been, God has given me the peace of knowing that he ain't through with me yet. Because if the Lord be for me, he's given me the peace of knowing that my latter shall be greater than my former. He's given me the peace of knowing that in all things he is working together for the good of them who love the Lord. So lift up your hands, open up your mouth, and look to the hills from whence cometh your help, and remind everything around you that a new day has dawned, and I will give God all the glory.
Yes.
Yes. I'm going to give him the glory. Because a new day has dawned. And when you understand that, you understand I'm not waiting for God to do. God has already done. And that gives your heart peace while you're waiting to see what God has already done. Bow your head.